Well, folks, welcome here. It is time to worship. What do you think? You can put that up. The weapon formed may be formed. Let's try that again. Ha! The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. Oh, my God will never fail. Why don't you try that with me? The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail.
See?
for good. You turned it for good.
Isn't that the story of Job?
You took what the enemy meant for evil, and you turned it for good. You turned it for good. You took what the enemy meant for evil, and you turned it for good. You turned it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. Heavenly Father, thank you for reminding us again and again and again that you can do good out of anything, that you could turn the lion's den into a petting zoo, and that you could turn a giant Goliath into just a battle that was fought by a young man, that you could take Job and the devil could challenge you and totally ruin his life, and you could make great things out of him. Thank you that you can take our messes and make them into beautiful things. God, would you move us to hand them to you? Would you move us to allow you to do that, to worship you, even in the midst of it? In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, good morning, everyone. Everybody is in full summer mode, aren't they? I think so. Yeah. You know, we have been so blessed to have my dad in our house. And in a month, he's gonna be going back to Bethany Manor. So we're just looking forward to all the new adventures that we get to have with him this next month. The last 2 years have been full, I will tell you, having Dad at home. Wow, he is an amazing man. And yesterday, he was picking cherries with Gwen at Pam's place for a little bit. I'm sure he wanted to go on the ladder. I'm sure he wanted to go to the top of the ladder. If you know my dad, he does everything he possibly can, and he does it as fast as he possibly can. But you know what that means is that in the evening, I got to have fresh cherry pie with ice cream. So the harvest is here. It's right around the corner. But if you've already got some berries in the back, we have a cherry tree in the back, but it's almost all gone. And we thought it was the robin, but it was really the Reuben that was picking all of the berries. So we looked and we said, why are the berries all disappearing? And we could see Dad kind of sheepishly looking over there. Oh, it's the Reuben bird that's been picking all the cherries. We have been so blessed to have Dad. But welcome here, everyone. I hope that you today, not just today, but in this place, you experience God and you experience fellowship. We're here to worship him. And why don't you turn with me to Psalm 48. And I'm getting old, so I'm going to put my glasses on. You will, when I first read this, I thought to myself, boy, this sounds familiar. It's because we used to sing it at camp all the time, around the campfire. And you will remember that if you're a little older like me. Psalm 48, great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. In the city of our God, his name, his holy mountain, beautiful in elevation, is the joy of all the earth. Mount Zion in the far north, the city of the great king. Within her citadels, God has made himself known as a fortress. For behold, the king assembled. They came on together. As soon as they saw it, they were astounded. They were in panic. They took flight. Trembling took hold of them there. Anguish as of a woman labor. By the east wind shattered the ships of Tarshish. As we have heard, so have we seen. In the city of the Lord of hosts, in the city of our God, which God will establish forever. We have thought on your steadfast love, O God, in the midst of your people. As your name, O God, so your praises reach to the ends of the earth. Your right hand is filled with righteousness. Let Mount Zion be glad. Let the daughters of Judah rejoice. Because of your judgments, walk about Zion, go around her, number her towers, consider well her ramparts, go through her citadels, that you may tell the next generation that this is God, our God forever and ever. He will guide us forever. Are there any announcements that anyone wants to make this morning? Anything we need to know for the upcoming week? Oh, I see a fresh one. How many days? And okay. Is it a little girl? And can you say it one more time?
Eleanor, Elva,
Ann. Wow. What a blessing, you guys. That is awesome. Yeah. Everybody's going to come around just to smell that little baby afterwards. There's something special about that, isn't there? Yeah. What a blessing. Any other announcements from anyone? Wingmen, we are going to, this Thursday, we're going to do a fireside. Connie, did Ken talk to you about that at all yet? And is that a go at your house? It's a go. Thumbs up. Which means on Thursday, we're going to go have like smokies and hot dogs and stuff like that. Sit around the fire at the Clausen house. So plan to be there by 7 o'clock, okay? It's going to be just a great evening. Guys, it's always fun when we can sit outside and eat meat. What can I say? We do that all the time. But we do a lot more than that, so you're certainly welcome. Gwen brought it to my attention that there are lots of announcements, but you kind of have to go looking for them a little bit. They get sent out to your email. So if you are not receiving that email from the church with announcements of what's happening throughout the week, please sign up. I think you could probably talk to Connie and she'll get you on that list. And just to give you an idea of, you know, what's happening with special events, childcare, and that kind of stuff. That goes to Gwen's email, so I get it secondhand usually, but that's okay. Okay, if there are no other announcements, why don't we have the children's feature? What's that? Oh, it's a video. You got it?
The Bible. It's 66 books of history, stories, letters, and poetry that fit together to form God's one big story. The epic adventure of how he created us and loves us so much that he made a way to rescue us. As we travel through the Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, we discover people who met God and found their lives changed forever. Inspired by the book of James, chapter 3, verses 1 through 6.
The book of James in the New Testament was most likely written by... Aha, you guessed it, James. But this James wasn't just a close friend or follower of Jesus. James was actually Jesus's brother. Okay, can you imagine growing up with Jesus as your brother? He and James might have wrestled or played ball or thought of inventions just like any other brothers. But eventually, James also came to believe that Jesus is God's son, the one sent to save the entire world. Mind blown.
I, James, am writing this letter. I serve God and the Lord Jesus Christ.
Okay, think about it seriously. What would it take for you to even consider that your brother was the Savior of the world? James saw that the power of God's Spirit was with Jesus, and James himself experienced that same power when Jesus returned to heaven. In his letter to a group of Jesus followers, James shares some practical wisdom. He makes it clear that if you believe in Jesus and rely on the power of God's Spirit, then your life should look like it.
My brothers and sisters, most of you shouldn't become teachers. That's because you know that those of us who teach will be held more accountable. All of us get tripped up in many ways. Suppose someone is never wrong in what they say, then they are perfect. They're able to keep their whole body under control.
James wrote that one of the toughest things you'll ever have to control in life is you. The things you do, and especially the things you say, make a big difference in the world around you. And just like Jesus used stories, James painted some pretty amazing word pictures to help us understand.
We put a small piece of metal in the mouth of a horse to make it obey us. We can control the whole animal with it.
Think of a horse. Horses are strong, powerful animals, but when this tiny piece of metal is placed in a horse's mouth, even a small person can easily control that huge horse. James gives another word picture too.
And how about big ships? They're very big. They are driven along by strong winds, but they are steered by a very small rudder. It makes them go where the captain wants to go.
Imagine a huge sailing ship. Some ships built now are so big, they're like floating cities. But ships don't come with brakes. They can't be stopped over a short distance. That makes it super important for a pilot to be able to steer easily. Here's what directs the ship: a rudder. Compared to that ginormous floating city of a ship, the rudder is tiny, but a single adjustment in the angle of the rudder controls the path of that entire ship. Not too long ago, there was this huge container ship called the Ever Given that was traveling through the very narrow Suez Canal. Well, the winds were really high, and the pilot just lost control. The rudder of that ship didn't do its job, and that huge container ship wedged tight. The canal was blocked for 6 days. Hundreds of ships were stuck behind it and couldn't pass. Shipping around the whole world was backed up. All of that could have been prevented if the pilot had controlled the ship's rudder. Which brings us back to this.
In the same way, the tongue is a small part of a person's body, but it talks big.
Everything that comes out of your mouth and the words that you write or type can change the direction of your day, your week, your entire life. Maybe your best friend makes you mad and a really mean insult pops into your head. If you let that fall out of your mouth, it could just ruin the day for both of you and even destroy your entire friendship. James gives us one more word picture to illustrate how important it is to control what we say.
Think about how a small spark can set a big forest on fire. The tongue is also a fire.
Fire can be a great thing. Imagine a cozy bonfire for toasting marshmallows. If you're outside on a freezing night, a blazing fire can even be life-saving. But those same flames can destroy life too. A tiny spark can flare into a huge wildfire within minutes. And that wildfire can race along at 7 miles an hour through the forest, or 14 miles an hour over grassland. It can destroy everything in its path. James wrote that we need to take our words as seriously as wildfire. Every word that comes out of your mouth has the power to give life and encouragement, or to hurt and destroy. That is a huge responsibility. And there's no way you can fully control your words or yourself on your own. But if you ask for God's help, you will be given the power of God's Spirit. And as James reminds us, you can choose your words wisely. And then what you say will begin to change your world for good.
Want to stand?
Who am I that the King of Kings would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Wow. There's a peace I've come to know. Though my heart and flesh may fail, there's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. wishes I heed not, nor man's empty praise. Thou mine inheritance, now and always. Thou and thou only first in my heart. High King of heaven, my treasure thou art.
Amen. You may be seated.
Check. Mic check. Hello. Yes, please do.
So I think we're going to be really blessed this morning. I was teasing Darren a little this morning. I called him Pastor Darren. And I think he is very pastoral, not just because he has that mic that looks really cool, that rock star mic.
You betcha.
But he carries the presence of God with him. And I'm really looking forward to what God's laid on his heart. Darren, why don't you come up and let me pray for you?
Right on. Thanks, Wendell.
Yeah. Father, I thank you for my brother, and I know that you've put in his heart something that we need to hear. So, God, I just pray that our ears would be open today and that you would allow it to influence us and impact us, Father. In your name I pray. Amen.
Yeah, I think Brother Darren sounds a little less intimidating than Pastor Darren, so we'll stick with that. Okay, so before I get going into my message this morning, Tony had kind of asked a while ago if I was willing to speak, and then kind of helped, here's a few topics, do you want to pick any of these things? And you guys ever know when it's like, I'm just going to quickly, and then fill in the blank with something that is not quick at all? I'm just going to quickly tidy the house, or clean the garage, or solve world hunger, or something like that. That was basically the topic I picked, which, you know, it seemed like a good idea at the time. I'll just pick this nice, easy, compact, one-verse little topic about what is God's purpose for our lives. Like, the number one existential question keeps people up at night. Yeah, this is easy. That's what I'll talk about. That's no problem. So, back in the day, I went to Miller, and I had a prof, and he said, if you're the guest speaker at a church, keep your message to less than 1 minute per year you are old. So, number one existential question, we'll keep it under 30 minutes, and what's the worst that can happen, right? Okay, so I have a little clip that I want to play first. It kind of talks about purpose, maybe not quite knowing the purpose exactly like we should. So if you want to play that clip first, and then we'll get going.
Whoa! Whoa, what a swim.
Scuttle, look what we found.
Yeah, we're in this sunken ship, and it was really creepy.
Human stuff, huh? Hey, let me see. Look at this. Wow. This is special. This is very, very unusual.
What? What is it?
It's a dingle hopper. Humans use these little babies to straighten their hair out. See, just a little twirl here and a yank there, and boy, ole. Yeah, I got an aesthetically pleasing configuration of hair that humans go nuts over.
A dingle hopper. What about that one?
Ah, this. I haven't seen in years. This is wonderful. A banded, bulbous snarf flat.
Oh.
Now, the snarf flat dates back to prehistorical times when humans used to sit around and stare at each other all day. Got very boring. So, they invented this snarf flat to make fine music. Allow me.
Music?
It's stuff!
Oh, the concert! Oh, my gosh, my father's gonna kill me! The
concert was today?
Maybe you can make a little planner out of it or something.
I'm sorry. I've gotta go. Thank you, Scuttle!
Anytime, sweetie!
So that's obviously kind of goofy, but I think sometimes God gives us a fork and we think we have a dingle hopper. And that's okay, because God can still use it. That's kind of what we're going to find out today. So this morning, Tony's been walking us through Job. We're going to stick in Job. The verse is chapter 10, verse 9. And Job is at a really low point. And he says, talking to God, he says, "Remember that you have made me like clay, and will you return me to the dust?" Now, that verse is small and innocent looking and not necessarily the number one existential question, but as we look at it, Job reveals this truth. He says, "God, you've created me." Well, right there, that's a big truth. And that God has molded him like a potter molds clay. So not only has God created us, but he's created us specifically for a purpose. Purpose is kind of a funny thing. Sometimes it's really obvious, the purpose of the device. Sometimes it's less obvious. When my wife and I were dating, she asked me a question that I thought had an obvious practical purpose. Turns out that in relationships, often guys are finger painting while girls have their PhD. She asked me, "I have to get my passport renewed, so how long should I renew that for?" And I'm thinking, well, per year, the longer you do it, the cheaper it is. So get it renewed for 10 years. Financial, good answer, passed the test. This was good, nailed it. Little did I know, her question is, am I going to be changing my last name anytime soon? Is this serious, or are we just hanging out for kicks? From a passport question, like, how am I supposed to know these things? Now, thankfully, with God, his purpose is not hidden. If you look at Scripture, there's lots and lots of verses that make it very clear what our purpose is and what God has set out for us. And a few hundred years ago, a bunch of these theologians got together, and they were trying to bring unity on topics within the church. They came up with the Westminster Catechism. And the number one point for their discussion on unity is God's chief purpose for man is to glorify God and enjoy him. And so that's what God has set out for us. It's not a hidden purpose. It's not a complicated purpose. It's not, here's 75 million rules for you to follow. It's one thing, glorify God and enjoy him. And so if that's our purpose, the question is, how do we do this? It's very clear, it's very simple, we got to glorify God. So God, thankfully, he created us, he knows us, he's equipped us even to do his purpose, he's given us talents and passions, and he's also given us some instruction as to how we go about doing this purpose. He sent his son, and in the life of Jesus, we get some very clear ways, some very clear teaching on how we go about fulfilling this purpose. And just one spot in Luke, Jesus talks about, if you take all of the teachings, you can kind of sum it down to love God and love your neighbor. And so in glorifying God, this world is really divisive and opinionated, and it's good to have opinions on things, and it's good to discuss things and even debate things. That's healthy. But can we do it while still loving the people that we maybe disagree with? Can we love the people, not just our best friend, not just our family, but I don't know, not a lot of people will know this. I'm a big Southern Gospel fan, and Mark Lowry, he sang with the Gaithers back in the 90s, and I remember watching Gaither Gospel Hour, and he said, you know, there's a lot of people that I love that I don't like. And I think sometimes we have to love the people that we don't like, and that's okay. God can work on our hearts and change relationships and heal relationships, but even in the midst of not liking people, we have to find ways that we can love people. And so Jesus, he says, love God, love others. And then in Luke 10, he talks about the parable of the Good Samaritan. And that, I think we all have heard that. It's been talked about. That really sums up loving someone that you really have no business helping, no business hanging out with, no business sacrificing for. But Jesus was the perfect picture of selfless love. And so that's what we can look to do in this world of, if we're wondering what does God have set up for us, let's love selflessly. That's a great first step. So more than just generally of, okay, God has me on this world to glorify him, I do that by loving people. That same prof that told me how long I should keep my message, he said, if you're speaking a message, you got to get to the so what. These are good truths to have, but so what? On Tuesday at 7:30, who cares? So what? What am I supposed to do in glorifying God and loving people? And I think I have three things just to speak to, kind of the practical, what does this mean for us? How does this affect us? Number one is purpose has value. If we are purposeless, we're not going to be very focused. If we have a purpose, whether it's in our occupation, I do this per hour, I am worth this much if I accomplish this task. It's a value attached to your purpose. There's this new golf circuit that's kind of trying to rival the PGA. They're paying Phil Mickelson, who used to be a top-notch golfer, he's kind of on his way down, but he's still got a name that kind of lends credibility and generates buzz. They're paying him $102 million per year to golf. That's his purpose. That's mind-blowing. But for us, in knowing what to do in our everyday lives, okay, what's my purpose? Well, when we know our purpose, that gives us clarity and direction, gives us a reason to wake up, gives us hope. It gives us reason to persevere. And I think that's an important thing, because when things are going well, when life is easy, then purpose maybe matters a little bit less, because it's just easy and we're not thinking those existential questions at 2 a.m. But God has given us this purpose. He tells us to love. And God is going to put people and opportunities in front of us where on a daily basis we get to fulfill this purpose. And so, if you're ever feeling anxious or lost or kind of just like you're spinning your tires, we all get to that point for sure. And just bringing it back to the simple truth of, let's find some people to practically have some difference-making love, and let's share that love with them, that can just kind of keep us going. Mike Tyson, he was a boxer, kind of known for being the hardest puncher out there. And one of his quotes is, everyone has a plan until they get hit in the mouth. And we get hit in the mouth in life. Job got hit in the mouth in life over and over. And it's hard to know what to do when you get hit in the mouth. Like playing sports, I've been hit in the mouth with a ball coming much too fast. And you really get disoriented. Your eyes start to water and you don't know what's supposed to happen. And just having a solid purpose that we can be fully confident in that God has for us, to love others, to glorify Him, that can help to reset us, especially when we get punched in the mouth. A second point of purpose is purpose gives us comfort. There's a lot of people my age and younger that feel anxiety. It's kind of at like an all-time high in the world these days. And one of the biggest things of anxiety is, what am I supposed to do with my life? I don't know. Well, this is a very clear purpose. It gives us comfort. It's comforting not only to have the purpose, but to know the God who created us, who's all-powerful, all-knowing, all-loving, sovereign. He's the one that came up with this purpose. So I don't necessarily have to figure everything out for myself. I know that God ultimately has it all figured out. Christ's finished work on the cross is already done. And if I can rest in that truth, then I can worry less. When we're told, do not worry about tomorrow, this is because the battle's already won when it comes to sin and salvation. And so it's not an excuse to not be diligent every day, but it just takes that kind of 2 a.m. anxiety away, because God already has the purpose set out, 100%, easy, done. And God, he's the one that made us. He's perfect, powerful, loving, all-knowing. He's the one that's equipped us. He's given us talents. He's given us passions. He's given us the Holy Spirit with the fruits of the Spirit. These are all things that he wants us to use to love other people, to edify the church. And when we get punched in the mouth and we think, man, I just don't know if it's all going to work out. If God is the one that made the plan, I don't know. I think it might work out. I think we might be okay. One more point, something kind of between a point and an observation, is God's purpose for us doesn't change, but I think where the rubber hits the road is how we go about fulfilling that purpose does change. And it really changes as our circumstance in life changes. If I'm 2 versus 22, 42, 62, 82, how I go about fulfilling God's purpose is going to change. The opportunities that God puts in front of me is going to change. And so, I think that's where we really have to, take encouragement that God has this all figured out for us. God is more than capable of setting us up to succeed, and that's what he's going to do. He gives us many, many opportunities, and if we get punched in the mouth, if we blow an opportunity, guaranteed there's many, many more coming along. But even as that's an encouragement, I think also we have to take on a little bit of a challenge and think, okay, in my day-to-day life, how can I do all that I can to be prepared for these opportunities? How can I really fully take advantage of these opportunities? And so, moving out of Job, I want to take us to Psalm 46:10. Not that a person necessarily has favorite verses, but one of my favorite verses. It's a verse that most of us have probably heard. It says, Psalm 46:10, "Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. Okay, so Psalm 46:10, it's if you read all of Psalm 46, it's not like a quiet, relaxing chapter. It's a wars going on kind of a chapter. And so I think when God says, be still and know, it's not a call to relax. This is a command, like I'm driving the minivan and I turn around and I say, be quiet, be still, or else I'm going to turn this thing around. This is a wake-up call, kind of a be still and know that I am God. I think in life, God ends up competing for our attention a lot more than he maybe should. And, you know, between Netflix and soccer practice and cleaning the house and tidying the garage and solving world hunger and all these other things that we get doing, God has to say to us, just, can you just be still for 2 minutes or 22 minutes? Because if God has this awesome purpose that he's created us for, and he's equipped us, he's given us the Holy Spirit, he's given us the example of Christ, he's given us all these things, he needs us to be ready to take advantage of those opportunities that he gives us. And if we're going to be still and know, number one is to be still. He commands us, just slow down, calm down. I'm trying to talk to you. Let's just talk. And then to know that I am God, how do we know something? Well, it takes time. It takes effort. It takes maybe some conversation, maybe some reading, maybe some listening. Maybe you're talking to other people that know more about the topic than you do and you want to learn. This is what I think God wants us to be doing in order to live out this purpose that he has for us. So as we study scripture and as we read and listen and pray, we get to know God more. This has all kinds of benefits for us. Number one, it's going to strengthen our faith in God as we get to know his character, because God is good. And it's one thing for a stranger on the street to be preaching that to you, and you hear it and you think, yeah, okay, that's nice. God is good. God is love. There's lots of great bumper sticker phrases that you can put out there. But if you can really get into scripture and take some time, you can see his goodness. It just keeps going and going and going. And it's going to strengthen your faith. It will give you confidence when you get punched in the mouth to know this is trustworthy and good, and the battle is already won. The other thing that we can do or gain from spending time in scripture and reading and praying is that our faith increases, but also the characteristics that he wants us to learn and emulate. We can look at Christ's example. We can look at the fruits of the Spirit. These things are going to become a little bit easier for us and a little bit more natural, especially if we're dealing with those people that we need to love but don't really like. That's when we can really lean on the Holy Spirit. He's our helper. His purpose here is to help us out with these kind of things. And it gets easier, I think. It's not easy, but it gets easier as we get more and more into God's word and become maybe a little bit more and more like Jesus every day. Finally, just as we read scripture, it becomes more obvious that God has given all of us specific talents and passions. He knows us. He knows our flaws. He knows our setbacks. He knows the situations that we're really going to excel in. He knows the situations that we're going to shy away from. He's probably going to give us opportunities in all of those situations, and it's okay if we don't take advantage of them fully, but it is one of those things where if God is the one that's given me a passion and God is the one that's given me a plan, even if I think, God, I'm not the right guy for this. I shouldn't be speaking this morning. I shouldn't be talking to so-and-so on my coffee break. There's got to be someone better equipped. But if God's the one that made this plan, it's going to be good. And you know, back to the Westminster Catechism when it said the chief end of man is to glorify God and enjoy him, it got me thinking, glorifying God is enjoyable? That's something that you don't necessarily think. Certainly younger in life, I mean, it's fun to sing and it's fun to go to youth group and it's fun to do all these things, but when life gets you down a little bit and maybe you're not even down, but you're just kind of on cruise control, sometimes you forget that glorifying God there's joy. He gives us the joy that we can really get excited about and passionate about, and it's contagious. That's what brings God glory, is when people see, like, why is this guy so weirdly joyful? Even if life is blah, or even worse than blah. But that's going to give you an opportunity to maybe share with someone or encourage someone or whatever it may be. And God, he'll give you lots of opportunities to do that. So, just as we kind of wrap things up here, God has a purpose for us. It's very clear. He's equipped us to succeed in this purpose. And even when we don't succeed, he's going to give us opportunity after opportunity after opportunity to succeed. So let's really think about how we can love like Jesus loves, that selfless difference-making love, not just like a kind word or some thoughts about, man, I hope so-and-so is doing better. Well, maybe bring so-and-so a meal or see if they need some help with some yard work or something that's really difference-making, practical. Small things can make a big difference in people's lives, especially when they're down. So as a challenge to all of us, let's just look for those opportunities. God's going to give them to us. Let's be still when it's Tuesday at 7:30 and we don't know what to do. Instead of watching that next episode, let's just be still. Let's listen to what God has for us. He's going to give us some good encouragement. He's going to give us some good words. And then as we take that time to get to know him, it's just going to get better and better and easier to find joy in glorifying God. That's what I have, so let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your goodness. God, we thank you that you are the one that has a purpose for us. We're not just on this earth for ourselves. Help us to remember that, especially, Lord, as we get punched in the mouth. We know it's going to happen, but we know that you're there right along with us when that happens, God. So we pray that you would help to grab our attention and give us joy in getting into your word, into discussing you with others, and into just getting to know you more and more. Lord, we thank you for the opportunities that you're going to put in front of us. We pray that you would help us to take advantage of those, that we would glorify your name in this world. Pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Darren. This is a time when we do some sharing and pray for each other. I want to thank everyone who's on today. Adam, is the camera still running? I think we turn it off during sharing time. If you could do that for us, that'd be great.
just want to read that verse that Darren was talking about, that 46 verse 10, Psalm 46, 10. I love that verse. I actually had Reuben paint a picture for me of the pillar of cloud and pillar of fire that the Israelites followed and that went behind them to separate them from the Egyptians that were coming. And I put under there, I wanted that verse, 46:10, and I found it in a translation that said, "Cease striving and know that I'm God." And because I don't know how to be still, I found cease striving more attainable. But since then, the be still is much easier. And we want to see this, sing this song, see a victory in the end. There's purpose in what we do, and that's going to change. But in the end, we know how this story ends. And it's pretty powerful. This verse goes, be still and know that I am God. And know that I'm, that's huge. I just kind of glossed over that, but Darren already said that, like, that's massive. I'm God. I'm God. I will be exalted among the nations. How many things do we see going on in the nations? I will be exalted among the nations. Not over the nations, not someday I'm going to dump on them. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth because the Lord of hosts is with us. And in the message that goes, the God of angel armies is with us. The God of Jacob, who was renamed Israel, who was the children of Israel, who God has promised to bless forever. That God of Jacob is our fortress. And that's where we fight from, that fortress. So we are going to see a victory. It's worth going out of our way to make the meal or build the fence or walk alongside somebody that's really struggling. It's worth it. And we're going to see the victory. Why don't you stand? The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. So I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the Jesus. Father, show us where to be still. And watch you work. And let us worship. And let that go before us. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For this battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Hebrews 13, verse 20 and 21.
Jesus Christ, to whom be glory.